My name's Sean Rainbird, Director of the National Gallery, and this is the fourth in our conversations, talks with between contemporary artists and other kinds of practitioners. And Amanda Coogan, welcome. Many, many thanks for taking up our invitation to have a conversation and make a presentation, have a conversation with Patrick Murphy from down the road, the Royal Hibernian Academy. Patrick will introduce Amanda's work briefly in a minute, and then Amanda will make a presentation, then they'll have a conversation, and I hope we'll have time for questions. And the reason I've gone through that at a rattling pace is that many of you, I think, have been here over the past few weeks. We've had a number of these conversations, presentations already. We're in our 150th anniversary year, which is a wonderful occasion to look back at the gallery's history, but also to look forward and to see how we would like to behave in terms of our responses to contemporary artists and contemporary art, what art's being made today, how the way of thinking and making art, how it actually comes into our world in the National Gallery, in that, of course, many artists working today, they've, particularly the Irish ones, they've grown up with this as one of the visual arts institutions. They have spent many idle and presumably non-idle hours admiring pictures, walking through the spaces, being inspired, just recovering, thinking, creating. And it's one of the functions of all museums. But at the same time, many artists, as we're well aware, see their art as part of a great long arc, a trajectory that takes them from the way they're thinking and doing now right back into the wonderful traditions of art, which are so well represented in this great National Gallery of Ireland. So we've been looking at current practitioners. We'll also be looking at members, for example, of our board, who have included, our board has included artists since the very beginning. In fact, two, Martin Gale and James Hanley, have works in a small display in room one, Governors, Guardians, Artists, upstairs. And we'll also be looking back over certain of the artists who have been on the board over the years, Sarah Purser, Sean Keating, Mani Jellett being three of many, and picking up their legacy in terms of the gallery later on in various talks. So there's going to be quite a lot of interaction with contemporary artists, and it's been a great burst of life and burst of fresh air to introduce this particular strand. And I'd like to thank my colleagues in the education department for setting all of this up. We're recording it, as you can see. And each week it's going to be slightly different. I think the little bird has just whispered that Patrick's going to be sitting on the stage when a man is presenting. And so we're having a slightly different mise en scène this week from last, and doubtless next week will give us another few surprises. And just before I go, I'd like to welcome Olive Braden, who is our outgoing chair, but has been extraordinarily helpful to me personally in my first couple of years here, and also to the gallery. You're well aware that we have the lorries coming next door as our refurbishment begins. And so we're doing a wonderful project to refurbish the Dargan and Milltown wings, after which we will be able to work with more living artists and we'll be able to hang more of our own collection. And certainly the work that Olive has done with the board in securing the political support, the financial underwriting, has been extremely valid. So I'd like to thank her, and it's very good that you're coming tonight, and thanks very much, all of you, for coming on this rather wonderful evening. And I'll hand over now to Patrick and Amanda. Many thanks.
Thank you, Sean, and I'd just like to commend the National Gallery for this series. To take Sean's metaphor of that arc of artists looking back, hopefully in another 150 years, the artists that should be at the that are at this conversations will be in the collection, and all the problems of how you collect contemporary art will be part of the National Gallery's remit. My first memorable presentation of performance art happened in Ellsford Terrace in 1980, during Ross Katie. I remember it was in a large room. Two figures entered the room, a man and a woman, both dressed in white shirts, the woman in a plain black skirt, the man in plain black trousers. The woman carried a bow, the man carried an arrow. They stood opposite each other. The man put the bow, put the arrow against the string of the bow, and they leaned back. The arrow was pointing at our heart. And he leaned back and he held that pose. And because of the strain of the bow, it began to vibrate, and the danger was imminent. Don't remember how it ended. I don't know how long. I don't remember how long it went on for. but I remember it being extremely powerful. Performance art has been with us in some guise or other since the early part of the 20th century. Going through the various modernisms, they all had this idea of the body of the artist being the artwork itself. It wasn't really until the 1970s that it sort of was academicized and started to enter into the sculpture departments of various art colleges. Famous incident in 1971, Chris Burden, an LA artist, had at a gallery opening, had his friend put a rifle bullet through his hand. I remember in Trinity in the 80s, Dorothy Walker, you may remember, lecturing us on this outrageous act. And this was the coming. The year previously, 1970, Gilbert and George from our neighbors next door had spent a whole day in Nigel Greenwood's gallery, which is a very famous gallery in London in the 70s, seeing underneath the arches. They refer to themselves as living sculptures. So this insistence on the body, on the artist itself, himself or herself, becoming an artwork. And Ireland was quite up to this at the time. I remember in the 70s, Alistair MacLennan, who was known as a durational performance artist, took up a post at the Belfast College of Art. And in our own National College of Art and Design, Nigel Rolfe took up a position in the sculpture department. And they were both teaching performance art. Amanda Coogan went to art college first in Limerick Art College to study painting. She then later went to NCD to pursue performance art and received a degree from there. At the end of 2013, she attained, via thesis and practice, a PhD for the University of Ulster. So we're delighted this evening to welcome Dr. Amanda Coogan. She's been described by the Irish Times as the leading practitioner of performance art in this country, and I think is one of the leading practitioners of performance art globally. She's worked in many galleries in the UK, Germany, Russia, Spain, and the US, and I'm delighted to introduce her to her now.
Thank you very much, and thanks for that lovely introduction. I'm just a new doctor, so it's not... I'm giving out prescriptions for durational performance art all the time, but I'm delighted to be invited here today. Excuse me as I pull up these slides. It's a real honor to speak about a very contemporary, a very current practice within the hallowed walls of the National Gallery of Ireland. And I'm deeply honored for Mary's invitation and Sean's invitation. And what a very interesting context to talk about my practice. And I've chosen to show you this first image. It's kind of chronological the way I've drawn this presentation here today. And this is from 2000 or 2001, I can't remember. And interestingly, is taken very much from a painting that is here in the collection of the National Gallery of Ireland that I would have seen as a young child, as a teenager. And I suppose in my evolution as a practitioner, I started to consider the activity of my body being much more important than the paintings I was making. So in Limerick School of Art and Design, I was in the painting department, a very, at that time, very traditional painting department where you painted with oil on canvas and those beautiful objects that we know, again, from the collection here. And I became much more interested, literally, in the physicality of making a painting and started exploring ways to look at that. And at that stage, I hadn't come across this fairly new genre of performance art, of art making, but which is very much contingent on, for my practice, on the artist's body. So I made this work, I've continued to make a series of Madonna works, but This is Madonna in Blue, and again, even titles would make reference to paintings within my work. And it is a companion piece with this piece called The Fountain. And if we think of The Fountain, I chose the name with reference to Duchamp's Fountain, and of course with reference to Bruce Nauman's Fountain. And I realize I don't have images of these, so I apologize if people aren't familiar with these works. But I do have some works, I have some images of works that I very overtly reference coming up.
Can I just ask you, I mean, the Bruce Nauman Fountain would have been Bruce Nauman in his studio in the late 60s, and video cameras had just become sort of ubiquitous. You could get your hands on the video camera. And he reckoned he was an artist in the studio, so anything he might do was making art. So he did something as fill his mouth up with water and blow it up and film that. He also did sort of funny walks. He did goofy things, and there's a great American word, goofy. He did goofy things in the studio that was based on him behaving, whatever way he was behaving.
And activities, yeah.
Activities.
Yeah, bodily activities.
Mm-hmm. And one thing I think that was very profound for me when we first met was to learn of your background before you went to Limerick College of Art, because you had a very specific type of upbringing.
Yeah, and I suppose really that's part of the reason why I became much more interested in the bodily activity of jumping up and down and trying to paint a large canvas. My parents are deaf, and my first language is sign language, Irish sign language, obviously as an Irish person, and sign languages aren't the same all over the world. So sign language is a manual visual language. You use the body. The parallels throughout the type of practice I've chosen are shockingly obvious. So with sign language, you must be in the first person. You must be there in person until the advent of Skype, which is fairly recent. So to communicate, you do it with your body. You do it with your facial expressions, with any kind of gesture and movement. And you must be in the same place at the same time. Certainly as I was growing up, to have a meeting as a deaf person, you had to go to a certain place at a designated time to have that conversation. So I suppose when I would have described it as found performance art, it was almost like finding the medium that was right for me or appropriate for me, where I could really explore things in a very, I would talk about having an embodied practice. So it's not about thinking through overtly the rational. I don't think of an idea or a concept or a theme and work it out rationally. I work it out through the body, and then post the work, I will then rationalize it.
I know you took some time between Limerick College of Art before you went to NCAD, but what was the experience of NCAD like for you then? Because you were specifically there to do performance.
Mm-hmm. I came out of Limerick School of Art and Design, and I went to Athens for a year, and then I to study in the Athens School of Art and Design, and I started making sculptures that were referred to the body. I don't have any of these images here. They're so old, I'd be mortified to show them, actually. And I set up a studio here, and I started inviting friends in to take photographs of these actions. I wouldn't have called them performances at that stage. And I went into NCAD's sculpture department to the wonderful Brian King at the time was running the department, and literally was banging the table saying, I need to know about this thing called performance art. What can you do? Can you take photographs? Can you take videos? What is it? And they were really wonderful. They brought Alana O'Kelly in to do some performance workshops when I was there, and Pauline Cummins was a staff member. Both who have performance practice in their within their practice, but probably more importantly, that's where I found what I wanted to do. But probably more importantly, I did my master's the following year, straight after NCAD. I went to Germany, and I did my master's with an artist called Marina Abramovic, who is the artist you talked about, who had the arrow of a bow pulled against her. Her heart when she was working with her partner at that time in the 80s. And there it was an immersion directly into the world of performance art. So it was a performance art department, and we didn't consider anything else. it was only about the live moment. And I suppose I really do need to talk to you about the whole notion of performance art. Really, it's a relatively new form, as Pat introduced it there, really started taking shape around the late 60s and 70s. And it is willfully cross-disciplinary and willfully cross-media. And I very much, you probably notice from a lot of contemporary artists, they don't align themselves. Very few people say, I'm a painter, or I'm a sculptor these days. Everyone just says, a visual artist, so that they're allowed to use any media. And I, in an opposite way, very much call myself a performance artist. But within that title, the limitations of media are, there is no limitations of media, but the focus and the clarity of focus by calling myself a performance artist is that it is about the body and about bodily activity. Be it, and a lot of my practice and the earlier practice here that I'm showing you tonight was focused on solo performances, but I have since invited many people in to perform with me, or I've curated other performance artists together in a kind of a group show that functions like a sculptural exhibition. But where was I going to go with this? performance art, so in terms of just any references, I'd also, throughout the work, make very cheeky references to things. So this is a kitschy tourist apron of the Statue of David. How simple. And popping it on and aping the stance and putting it out the back garden barefoot gives it beautiful new nuances that you can do with playing with imagery like that in photography. And you'll see I'm showing photography here tonight. I'll make a distinction when the photographs come from live performances, which is a turn I made kind of a couple of years later, around 2005. But these are all studio photographs, so photographs I would have set up particularly for the camera. But performance as a relatively new genre crosses a lot of disciplines. So it crosses the disciplines of theatre, the visual arts, dance, even music and sound. And in the visual arts, it, as I say, can mean that it means that you can use any medium. You can use photography, video, objects, text, and live performance, all of which I incorporate in my work. And just to get to a little, I suppose, I'm calling the literature review section of my presentation. A lot of my work, I would overtly reference the emerging canon of performance art practice, because with such a new genre, you can kind of it can be read very much as you're blowing around in the wind without any anchorage. So a piece of mine called Molly Blooms, and I made it. This is on Blooms Day in Centre Culturel Irlandais in Paris. But I had performed her a number of times before and thought that and she wasn't in a doorway. And for this particular live performance, I decided to make reference to Marina and Ulay's Imponderabilia, which is one of the canonical performance art pieces now. These are the two artists that had the bow and arrow piece, Rest Energy, in Roskin, 1980. And then again back to the Madonna series. This was the first of the Madonnas that I made. I'm jumping slightly chronologically here, but very much in almost in a manifesto kind of way. This piece was really important. She was on a plinth. She was wearing the clothes of performance artists' suit. We can think of Piero Manzoni. And of course, of Gilbert and George. This is the living sculpture, singing sculpture. Underneath the arches. Dancing on the lamppost, I wanted to call. Underneath the arches there as well. So I'm very much playing with that idea, playing with lots of ideas. There's so many layers to the works, and I'm very happy to answer any questions in terms of the layering of the works. And again, there's Boyce, Joseph Boyce, who interestingly visited Ireland in the early 70s. And again, a canonical work called How to Explain Pictures to a Dead Hare. Very much a Madonna, has been described as a contemporary Madonna and Child. And I took that for a photographic piece that I made around a live performance, which I'll describe a little bit later. And very much, it's called Madonna and Handbag. And in terms of that work, I'll just move you on to this piece here, and I'll slip back to this. It's the cover of a Marina Warner book that I was reading at the time about Madonna, but the image is an image from the National Gallery in London of a an icon. I'm having a senior moment remembering the name of it. And I took that absolutely and reappropriated it, replacing the baby Jesus with a Chloe handbag. And for the live performances in a very beautiful church in Lichfield, that was part of a music festival, actually, a classical music festival. And I dressed all the angels. I painted it very much, painted it in the colours of this this painting that was in the front of that book, and replaced the baby Jesus, as I say, with a Chloe handbag. And we all adored the handbag during the performance, moved very gently and slowly to Mozart's Requiem, actually, very cheekily. I'm just showing this in terms of the kind of magpie-esque pinching of different images and ideas that I would carry through my work, really. And again, this piece is called How to Explain the Sea to an Uneaten Potato. Again, I'm making reference very clearly to Joseph Boyce, and I have the gold leaf applied to my head, but I'm sitting under my own weight in raw potatoes. So I've made a necklace or a mound of these raw potatoes. But I think really, primarily, I use my body, as I've described, to explore ideas. And these ideas are explored literally through doing, through action. My performances are long. This was, I think, a 6-hour performance. But a 6-hour performance where nothing happens. Nothing overt happens. There's no action. I literally do nothing. I'm moving my eyes. I sometimes address the audience with my eyes. I don't speak. And very interestingly, I think I wanted to describe the difference between live performance, and now we're moving into images of performances that I've made live in front of an audience, in comparison to performance works that happen to camera. And within the umbrella term of performance art from the visual arts, you can have both are equally made and acceptable as the name performance art. But for me, there's a huge distinction. So this is a little piece I made called Snails After Alice Marr. I was asked to interpret some Alice Marr, beautiful Alice Marr snail drawings. So what else is a performance artist going to do? Only put the snails on her body and make those beautiful trails. I don't know if you can see it so well from that. They made these beautiful glowing snail trails along the skin. And so this was made in my back garden, actually, because I had lots of snails, with a crew to a camera. So there's no slippery live performance moment. And then this is it in Imma as a 2-hour live performance. Excuse me. And a 2-hour live performance I would consider quite short. And I can talk about duration a little bit later if we have time. But something completely different then happens. So I, as a visual artist, construct and conceive the image, and I'll just go back there. Very clearly, the snails are exactly where I want them to be, you know, as much as you can have animals behaving themselves on you. It's very clean, it's very precise, and then we get this wild slippiness. They've broken the wall, they've come outside of the frame, these animals, they've pulled the gold leaf that I had on my chest up around my face, and the snails are hanging off my chin like a carbuncles or witchy kind of a bearded lady. Terribly interesting. I'm crying because one of them has just slid over my eye. Not emotional crying, simply the fact of snail slime on your eyes. So it's completely different image making. And I think for me, it reads much more potently of something having happened or something happening. It's, if we remember, a photograph is a snapshot. It is a split second of occurrence. Things go on and on and on. This is one shutter opening and closing in the moment of a two-hour live performance. But dynamically, there's some kind of dynamism there for me in these live performance images. And as my practice started getting further and further into long durational performances, I realized that I couldn't recreate the taxation on the body, that slippage, the slipperiness, the unknown instability of live performance. I couldn't replicate that in the studio under beautiful conditions and get a beautiful photograph, which is then the object that I, that continues my practice, lets people know what it is, what I can show people, what I, what can be collected out of my practice. So I went back to looking at photography from the live performance. This is a very important piece within, I think, within my, certainly from my perspective, within my practice called Yellow. A very simple, everyday performance. The woman sits on a bucket of water. The bucket, happily you can't see it there, but it's like a plinth, but it can hold water in it. And she literally rubs her dress is oversized dress, over and over and over for 4 hours. That pretty much. You can stand up occasionally. You can sit back down. Occasionally, I take the dress in my mouth. Again, it makes this beautiful witch's beard. So there's lots of transformation moments within this very everyday performance, except that it moves into endurance. And I'm going to talk a little bit later about endurance and what that means in performance art. But just to, I then invited a number of women, five other women, to perform the piece for me as well, to sit in on the bucket, sit in the dress, and for 4 hours each, and really to explore what might happen. It was very dynamic. The result is a four-hour film, where the cameraman literally wore the camera and didn't close the shutter. So you can see for 4 hours every moment that each of the performers make during the piece. But Yellow, the colour, I suppose, in terms of my practice and myself, and Pat have been talking a little bit about this, colour, I suppose, is really important in my practice, and it might refer back to my training as a painter. But I went on in this period for about 2-3 years simply just to use a lot of yellow in the work. So this is called The Yellow Mountain, very simplistic titles. And all of these little, I had been working with 15-year-olds on a lovely project in West Cork, and they all lip-synced to the Hallelujah Chorus as they're coming out of this little mountain of Aran jumpers. A piece I've called Cut Piece, that makes clear reference to Yoko Ono's Cut Piece, and again, a seminal performance artwork from the late 60s. But this, with this work, I cut myself out of a skirt And I have chosen this photograph out of the thousands of photographs of this live performance. So I will go through them and I will choose an artwork. So this is an artwork called Cut Piece as Mountain, again with the lovely yellow stuff. But just really to touch on duration and endurance in performance art. So I would work in extended duration. And by that I mean, as I said, 2 hours is very short for me. I really like mimicking the opening hours of the gallery. So the gallery opens at 10, I'll be there, started at 10. And if the gallery closes at 5:30, then I'll finish at 5:30. And as you can imagine, even sitting down for that amount of time has a little petite endurance, petite masochistic performance elements to it. And this is a really interesting illustration in terms of what changes, how a work changes over duration when endurance starts coming into the body. So this is a piece called The Fall. And this was a photograph, I had a wonderful photographer come into the studio while I was making this big mound. And I hopped up and was bouncing on it. The deal was that I was commissioned by a beautiful gallery in Manchester called the Whitworth Gallery. And I had chosen to work with the stairs and I was going to jump off the stairs onto this mound, do a backflip repeatedly for 4 hours. So I was constructing the piece here in Ireland and at the very beginning, before it was sent over to the UK, I took some photographs of it. And then I brought it to Kevin Kavanagh's gallery to do a first outing. So to do a full 4 hours with the public, with the invited audience. And you can see there that I've gone beyond the visual artist there. The body is starting to kick in. I'm going beyond performing. And I think it might be interesting to talk about performing. I'm performing today as somebody giving a talk, but I'm not performing as an artwork. And there is lovely, beautiful nuances and differences there, which I'd be happy to discuss. But so the image making starts going out of my control here. The straightness of the body, this taxation on the face. And then I went over to the exhibition in Whitworth was for 17 days, 4 hours a day for 17 days, and a radically different piece emerges. Things changed every day, things moved. Live performance is completely unstable. It changes every time you make a new performance because it's contingent on the context. We live in this postmodern world where context is everything. So it's really inflected, I would call it, by time, by the, you know, the day that you do it, literally, by the how long you do it, by the audience that are there, and by sight, as in the gallery, where, you know, or the street, or wherever it is that you are choosing to make these performances.
Would you rehearse those performances before you do
them? Well, there's a photograph there, will we go back to it, of, in inverted commas, a rehearsal.
Rehearsal. And yeah. Would you do a four-hour rehearsal?
No, I'm too lazy.
Okay.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I don't have the kind of, I don't know, grit, I suppose, to do it. I really need audience. Because I think, in other terms, people talk about performance art as a conceptual art form, which is really interesting. So it's non-rational conceptual art form. And I was going to go on to, I think, the next slides. This is the very piece I was going to talk about this with, because the artist commits to the idea of jumping off the stairs for 4 hours a day for 17 days. And my commitment to that as an artwork will drive me to do it. Whereas if I'm in the studio practicing, trying it out, rehearsing, whatever terminology you like to call it, I'll go, oh, that's a bit boring or sore or something like that. There's a whole other context then when I have an obligation and a duty and a commitment to making a performance for X amount of time in a certain place. This is an interesting work in this regard. It's called The Passing, and I made it in the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. Very beautiful gallery. They were opening a new wing on contemporary art, and I asked them, could I walk up and down the stairs for 24 hours? The gallery happened to be open for that period of time. For different reasons, they were showing another artwork, a film work, that was 24-hour work. And I would never do it again, by the way, as a human being. It was horrific. I have to go to my notes here. So I conceived of this idea, and I committed to the audience, to the concept of that I would literally walk up and down the stairs for 24 hours. And this extended duration, as you can imagine, every day we walk up down the stairs every day. It's as we all know how to do it. But to do it over an extended period of time implies something massively different. And I have, I'm moved that work on from the live performance and from the beautiful photographs that I have from the live performance. And I collected some ideas or thoughts about this work, literally from audience members who had been there, or my minders. I had a team of minders. These things don't happen without a lot of structures. They're super simple pieces of work, but there's a plethora of structures behind them. And I had some beautiful, really interesting feedback from feedback or stories, and it really makes one made me reflect or consider that actually live performance art is super contingent on the storytelling and on the experience of it. So super contingent on the audience, and it invites. And this artwork in particular, there's lots of other artworks that are explain this, but it invites the audience in as meaning makers of the work. And by that I mean that it's so interesting to be here in the context of the gallery. So and talking about an unstable, slippy form of art practice that changes constantly as the artist performs it. And how do we it's uncontainable until it's still slippery and messy. Marilyn has a different view to it, to Creighton, to other people who said, I don't understand what's all this rubbish all about. All super valid reactions to it. But I collated those together to make another artwork. So extending it in repercussions. So what does, how can one contain performance art is a current question, especially as museums and galleries around the world are starting to collect them. So in the essence of collecting an artwork, what do you do? And I've sold works to institutions. I've sold photographs mainly to institutions, but now things like live performances are being collected. I'm slipping up trying to not.
I bring a practice to something. I mean, I'm just thinking that you say that so quickly, 24 hours performance, walking up and down the stairs, but that first step, that first moment of a 24 hour period, what does that do psychologically and physically to you during that period?
What I would do is I would. With all performances, really, obviously there's a little physical preparation, but I'm not. I'm again a little lazy in those terms, but so you'd prepare pretty well, and then you step into a performance. And I would often say to anyone who's minding me or assisting me in a performance, "See you on the other side." So then you absolutely give over everything. So there is no tomorrow. There is only the now. That's what you're attempting to do, to be completely in the present moment. There's only now, there's only my next step, and then there's the next step, and I might pick up my dress, I might have to do something with it to shake me out of being hallucinating with exhaustion, which happened a couple of times during the, especially in the latter half of it. And I think that the works are very slow. I very slowly walked up and down the stairs, and especially in the second day, so it was 7 o'clock in the evening until 7 o'clock the next evening. So especially in the afternoon of the second day, I was very, very slow. And I think that slowness, that metabolism, a lot of my work is very slow, the activity is very slow, so that goes completely against our metabolism of current consumption. We want everything fast, everything, you know, I'm on the email on two computers, and I'm on Skype and Twitter and Facebook and constantly receiving and giving information. So when you take everything right back, and I have just one job to do in a live performance, and I am only doing that, and I'm only thinking about that place and that time, I think when you hit that and you sing in that area, the audience know it and can join with you and feel that as well. This is with this piece, I don't know if I am. Yes, this piece particularly talks about eye gaze.
Well, that's what I was thinking just there, because it's not a trance-like form you're going into.
No.
And you do talk, in here it is actually quoted here, like just of catching someone's eye.
Yeah.
And holding the gaze, mm-hmm. but reassuring them that everything's okay by giving them a blink.
Yeah.
So you can become very conscious of your audience during these extended.
It's kind of a lucid brain moment where you're absolutely in the present moment, you're absolutely with the work and what the work needs, and then you're understanding how you can communicate that, I suppose. And when you're in a kind of a depth like that, it's like a stone going down in underwater into the sea. And you can become my presence, and this is a contentious term within performance art world, but if I describe my work as an embodied practice, so, and we all have this presence, we all have this bubble around our physical selves that you don't step into unless you're, we all know this kind of air arena around you. So when you're performing, you extend that. You work very particularly to extend that out and take over the, you know, if I'm making a performance piece here, I'll be checking out the room and how can I get my energy down to the end of it and bring it around again. So your energy is very, very, very big. And especially with duration like that, so you can be super scary to.
Is that energy fed by the audience?
Yes. Because I'm too lazy, I wouldn't do it unless I had an audience okay. there. I wouldn't, you know.
So it's a real act of communication for you.
Well, and this is really interesting, the next little piece I have here, because the audience can are totally activate in very subtle ways. So I'm feeling with this piece, I need some particular energy, and I pick somebody to have a moment of individual communication with, or people came up to me and to do it. This simple eye contact, and it kind of feeds you. It nourishes you. It keeps you going on the journey. And this piece was very much a journey. I'm aware that I'm really not talking emotionally about why I make these pieces. And please, let me know if you want to know. I never fully know, but. The layers and layers and layers of these. But very interestingly, I work in a way called tableau vivant. So it means that, as I say, I would be in the space before the audience come, and I want to leave the space. I want the audience to leave before I leave. So therefore, in the mind's eye, you will think that performance is still going on. You don't see the collapse and the closure of it, and thanks very much, though I'm never opposed to somebody clapping my performance or anything like that, but that it holds in the mind's eye. And it's very much speaking to sculpture. accept that it's another human being. But really interestingly, this was such a big duration, and I very obviously taxing on my body, that the audience in this museum, you know, I'm sure you have it here, I've never been here at 5:15, but the museum has these announcements. The museum will close in 15 minutes, the museum will close in 10 minutes, the museum will close in 5 minutes, and the museum is now closed. And the audience refused to leave, completely refused to leave. The guards were trying to push them out, there was a scuffle. I was going, oh, please don't make me do another 5 minutes. Because, you know, for me, it's really important that they continue. They're leaving and they're going home. The door is closing behind them and they can still see me walking up and down the stairs. But in the end, it was too much of a standoff and I had to break it. I had to leave. They couldn't. We all have these behaviors that we, nice, polite behaviors that we have when we go to museums and galleries, and you behave in a certain way, you don't touch paintings, we all very nicely behave. So very interestingly, this group of, it was about 150, maybe 200 people, completely went against any kind of normative behaviours of museum goers and refused to be, I think as Marilyn here says, shuffled out of the gallery. So very dynamically changing the work. Really, for me.
Did you take any break in that 24 hours?
I allowed myself to go to the bathroom.
Okay.
So I think I notated the bathroom breaks. I think I had 6 breaks. Okay. And I allowed myself to drink water, but on site. So I had assistants who would give me some water. When I was on toilet breaks, I had little sachets of honey that I ate. And about 3:30 in the morning, I lay down on the stairs for about 45 minutes.
When you
awake, though,
when you finish a performance like that,
mm-hmm.
is there a come down? Is there an aftermath? I mean, I'm just thinking if actors come off stage, you know, they're sort of revved. They need time to wind down before.
Mm-hmm.
Are you revved when you come off? Or are you exhausted?
I'm usually exhausted, actually. I'm usually the other way around. And I would be nervous if I'm revved, because then I haven't given everything to the performance. It's a little boring. I wanted everything to be in. But if it's only a 2-hour performance, then I'm like, yeehaw, where's the table? I need to stand on it. But I'm sure my husband should have other things to say about that.
And is there a reflective period after a performance like that of things you learned during the performance that you want to hang on to add to future works?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So this piece, for example, came out of, I can make a clear lineage, yellow, did you see the yellow pieces there? And I was talking about the lovely bubbly beard that happened by accident in a live performance, or that I noticed in a live performance. I thought, ooh, how interesting. And I brought that into another piece that I'm just about to show you, where I asked a couple of women were performing with me, and I asked them to make these bubbles in their mouths, like a baby. I did have a small baby at home at the time. And then I extended that further to make this super sculptural object coming out of my mouth. I mean, it takes about an hour and a half maybe to get that much bubble, to bubble up like that. But yeah, so it very much, during live performances, things emerge and you go, ooh, I might have a little look at that, and you bring it to the studio and then you test it or rehearse it. I don't really like the word rehearse, because it implies a kind of theatrical form, where a live performance has to be open to chance. For me, it has to be open to the present moment and chance occurrences happening. But I was going to talk about this piece, is, I think it might be kind of interesting in terms of cross-disciplinary. I showed you at the very beginning a piece called Medea, which I made ages ago, 5-hour performance, and I tell these tremendous stories in Irish Sign Language. So it's a lot, very physical piece. And in 2005, a wonderful curator who just died today, Jan Hote, rest in peace, asked me to make it on in a museum in northern Germany on this chaise longue, which was designed by an artist theatre director called Robert Wilson. And I happened 5 years later to be invited to work with Wilson and on a play or opera about the life and death of Marina Abramović. And it was because I was an old student of hers that he asked me to be involved in. And I said, by the way, I had performed this piece on your chaise longue a couple of years ago, and he asked me would I lend the piece to him. Really interesting in terms of appropriation and lending a piece to a different context and it being reappropriated in that term. I think appropriation art practice is something that runs all the way through my work. You can see Snails After Alice Marr and then all of the other overt references I'm making in photography to canonical works. But so I was really interested to have the tables turned, but to be in control of it and still performing it. And this is my Medea in Robert Wilson's work on the life and death of Marina Abramović. Terribly complicated, but which is why it's super, super kind of interesting. I didn't mean to put the two of those in. This is another version of it. We're walking, where she glides along the stage. And he also appropriated yellow, which was a little more difficult for me, because I think yellow was still super fresh, and yellow is all about endurance. Medea wasn't so much about endurance. It was, it was 5 hours, but it wasn't really difficult. Psychologically difficult stories I was telling, but it was, you know. Yellow, you get cold. You get, your body shakes because you're wet for so much time, and this gives a really wonderful frisson to the practice. And here I sit on stage. Here we are doing lovely yellow, which is lit green. And I do it for 5 minutes. And then the scene is over, the curtains come down, and we change to another costume. I found that disjuncture very difficult because I'm used to sitting on a bucket and going and giving over. Bam, I'm here for 4 hours, for 5 hours, 6 hours, whatever, and life can go to hell. I'm just doing this. I had to get to grips with the mechanics of theatre.
Were you acting it?
I struggled for this play run for 3.5 years, and I struggled up to December, which was the last time we did it, to try and not act, to try and get some authenticity to it, but which is ridiculous, because I suppose what they say about the difference between theatre and performance art is that theatre is about faking it, not making it, and performance art is about making it. This is the piece that really I was very challenged by. I loved the dress that he made for, you know, he had made for me.
We'll get back to the dresses later. but within that idea of, I mean, working with someone like Wilson, mm-hmm. Einstein on the Beach, famous theatre producer and director, Did that bring anything to your practice that you could take away from the theatre?
Absolutely, absolutely, and I think a kind of precision of action. I think it's very interesting. It's part of the what is positive and negative about performance art from the visual arts is that we're not trained, so you can just go into your studio in NCAD and put a camera up and decide to make things. There's no particular training. And Bob is very much about being in the present moment, and he talks about a physical way of holding yourself that opens up the presence. And Martha Graham talked about a train that her dancers were on. So all of those descriptions are super interesting for me. And the precision of articulating an idea in space, that you don't just go, oh, I want to put my hand there, that you consciously, that it's a sculptural object. Once I put it in a certain way, with some tension. It's read much more clearly, I suppose.
So does that mean that within your own practice now, with preparing for a performance, you pay more attention to those nuances or the sequences of gestures and how you're going to do them?
I don't know.
Okay.
Let's see. I think that I do choreograph, in inverted commas, a little more precisely, but I'm still always looking for the tension between following the moment and hitting...
For chance.
Chance has to be involved. This piece, I invited these two young artists to perform with me, and I gave them very clear ISL signs, actually, choreographed movements, whatever context we want to call them. But I gave them very clear actions to make that were based on ISL, on Irish Sign Language. And my instructions to them, so I had to teach them these signs and my instructions, and I had to teach them how to stand in this special way that I wanted. But my instructions were always, you don't have to do those. If you're in another moment, keep with the moment. And I suppose after time, we did it for 2 months. It was part of Dublin Contemporary, if anyone saw Dublin Contemporary. And we did it over Dublin Contemporary for 2 months. So after a while, we really got to understand each other and see each other and know, you know, we could jam together in that way as a group would, you know, we knew it.
What about costume is really important in your practice. I mean, it's very interesting how your practice sort of shadows a lot of what you would get in conventional theatre, but doesn't go there. Do you design and make costumes yourself, or have them made?
My dad's a tailor. It's all cottage industry here. Super cottage industry. So I usually this is huge, that the skirt of this takes over the whole room, almost like St. Bridget, you know, the way she put her cloak down and took over the field. That's what I was, where I was thinking. But I'd usually try and lay them out and have them to a certain extent where I go, will you put a seam in that, Dad? Or if I have a problem, we can work it out. We can go, how would you make this or that? Some of the work, my poor dad is challenged by my work, as any father and daughter would be. So sometimes when I just want him to make a skirt and he says, what about the top? And I go, well, you don't need to worry about that. but he's very... we've come to an understanding about those.
And do you describe a different emotional register to different colours? I mean, we have had red, blue, yellow, mm-hmm. You know, you always use these very strong primaries.
Yeah, I think unfortunately I'm in a blue period at the moment. I couldn't really tell you why I've chose those colours at the beginning. Ochre is a super, you know, I would use ochre when I'm drawing all the time, when I make watercolors, or I use coffee or tea quite a lot in my drawing. So that kind of yellowy ochre, I could see where that was coming from. I extended it onto to make it really yellow. But I think that it very much relates to probably my drawings. Before I do make a performance, I draw ideas. Sometimes they're just gestural drawings, and sometimes they're much more specific. And so often a paint stroke just translates as a ream of fabric that's hanging off hips or on someone's back, or, you know, that it's very much a translation of the drawings or the idea of that hue of pigment. So probably super related to painting. And in terms of costume and object making, then I suppose this is much more about a kind of sculpture. is 9 coats sewn together, and I didn't torture my dad making him sew these. I just did it myself. But literally, it's a huge object, almost like a monster, that I could walk around. I could just about carry it. Well, it's quite heavy, and you drag it along. But again, really important in terms of the kind of potency and symbolism. So I didn't make these. These were literally bought in pennies. So off the shelf, whatever you call it, which I rarely do actually. And so they have, and because they're that puffer jacket thing, they have a kind of form, which was really delicious to play with, and it just functions in those terms as kind of a trail or a caterpillar, or, you know, all these arms are hanging out of it and all these neck holes waiting for heads to pop out of.
And was that a durational performance as
well? It was, 6 hours.
6 hours,
oh,
yeah.
This particular one was up in Queen's University for the Norton Gallery, actually, and it was only 6 hours. But before that, I'd made it for 8 hours runs. Again, the opening hours of the gallery, I think it was, but also a normal working day, 8 hours. We didn't do 9 to 5, we did 10 to 6.
We're getting near the end here, so I should ask the audience if there's any questions you have for Amanda. As she's speaking, please just ask.
And I do talk terribly formally about the work as well. I do apologize. This is a piece that I just made a couple of months ago in the Hugh Lane, called 13 Women. And the amount of images, very rich images, and as I say, I would often drop into appropriations. Here's not I. Beckett's Not I coming out here. My computer's gone a little slow. The audience then are so important in terms of containing, allowing me to stay there. This was a 12-hour performance. I invited 13 women to come in and out of the performance with me. The audience can keep you there. Your commitment to the idea for an audience keeps you focused and present. And then a beautiful dynamic shot that's not, again, it's something that comes up in live performance where I would have choreographed with these women in a very loose way, that the piece had a soundtrack going over it, slowed down Beethoven's Seventh Symphony. But on top of that, I sung the words to September 1913. And if I can say, it was very much contextualized at the time because we were in, it was 2013 and we were in the Hugh Lane, and the Yeats poem refers to the Huling. So occasionally, every 5 or 10 minutes, one word, me singing "Romantic Ireland's dead and gone," would just pop over in between the soundtrack. And the girls could choose to make the sign for Ireland at that time, or the sign for romantic, or just hear it and make those signs, which I taught them, at some stage. Later, it was an offer of some hooks. But the most important thing that they were doing was breaking holes in this fabric and popping out from it, and then drowning or going back down inside it. So constantly moving, or just their hand come out, just their foot sometimes, their head. It was very, very open. I asked them all to invest their own practices in the work. Really opening the work up to the chance-driven, slippery, dynamic, for me, unstable kind of.
The voice doesn't really figure in your work, does it?
No.
Never.
No. I suppose that I've kind of been vehemently anti-text up until this September when I brought in the Yeats poem. But you would have to have been there for 3 hours to hear the whole full poem. So I really broke it up. So it wasn't narrative as such. It didn't have a beginning and an end. I have been very anti the word, I suppose, or I really haven't used the word a lot.
But I mean, you do use language, but it happens to be sign language, so it's only some people able to read that.
Yeah. You're right. I use vocabulary all the time, sign vocabulary all the time. But probably particularly because it is gestural and it's a movement, and no one knows what I'm saying.
There's a question there.
I was going to ask a question. When you mentioned training of people, is a certain amount of the activity choreographed?
Yeah. Loosely choreographed, where I'd give them a few gestures. I think for this piece, I taught them maybe how to sign the full sentence, "Romantic Ireland's dead and gone, it's with O'Leary in the grave." Or actually, my translation of that, which wouldn't have followed the exact words. So I would have taught them that, and I would have asked them to slow it down or just pull it apart, just take one gesture, one word, you know, that they didn't have to be narrative about it. So they could just say romantic, in sign language, obviously, or Ireland. And I think the woman at the very top is just finishing signing Ireland there, possibly. I'm not too sure. I was going to play this video. Some of you might caught the end of it as you were coming in, which is a time-lapse video of the full 12 hours of the performance. It squished down, and I play with metabolism there, squished down to 8 minutes. And I thought I had it loaded up here. I might have knocked it off there by but I'm happy to sit down beside you now, Pat.
I mean, with the Dublin Contemporary piece in 2011, which was the three people, mm-hmm. and now with this 13 people, do you now have a choice? Has it widened your vocabulary or your practice that you can work in troupe, work in group, or work singly?
I think so. I think that I've probably become more confident about how I can teach what I want or explain what needs to happen. And I found people. Yellow was a really big experiment for me because I was asking other women to sit down and be cold and go through a physical experience for 4 hours, and I was really nervous about asking some people to do that.
And they did that sequentially, they didn't do it all at the same time.
They did it night after night night. So it was six nights, night after. So nobody was there at the same, there wasn't two performers going on at the same time.
And there was no audience?
Oh, there was.
Oh, there was an audience.
Oh,
okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Audience every night, all the time. Okay. Packed. Absolutely. And the audience got bigger and bigger and bigger as the days went along, and people came back to see how different performers would deal with them.
With the same piece.
Yeah. Yeah.
We must have some more questions. Here we go, here.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's a shared, yeah, it's very much a shared experience. I think so. That's a really interesting question, because it's all very well and good for me to have a lovely experience and not communicate that. So I think if there is a moment where you're in your brain, you're in the present and you're in the experience, but you're also, the other side of your brain is making sure that you're communicating that. And that's kind of the key or the essence to it. And what I found really interestingly is that the audience drop into this presence or flow as well. Audiences, not everybody, of course, it's not to everybody. This is a very visceral experience. To experience performances is not, there isn't a distance. It's a much more subjective experience, or you oscillate between objectivity and subjectivity. So, for example, if you're looking at a painting, there's a distance between you and the object. When you're looking at a live performance, it's a little bit more visceral. But what happens is that audience members spend a lot longer with the live performance. They engage on a human-to-human way. And what you find is that you lose sense of time sometimes when you're in a live performance. I do. And so you experience this idea of being in the present moment. It's a very special audience that come to live performances. It's not for everybody, and people definitely make a decision, just like we make a decision to go to theatre anyway, we have to buy a ticket. So you make a decision to come into the gallery and consider the beautiful paintings. You make a decision to come to live performance, so you're deciding to engage in that context. And that pocket of community is together. The performer and the live audience. Not the audience that are watching it maybe over Skype. It's a different experience for them, but when you're in the same room, we're all breathing the same air. We're all sharing molecules as such, so we're all sharing the idea, but we all have different experiences.
Are you vulnerable to negativity in that situation?
Like with somebody taking the piss?
Yeah.
Would you know, I did a performance, and this is hilarious, in Serbia. It was curated by Marina Brown, which is from Serbia. And she curated a couple of us young bucks to go over, like idiots. And I made, I showed you a piece called Mississippi Goddamn, so I'm throwing milk in the air. I'm standing like a Kill Bill poster, throwing milk in the air. So I did that on a wall in Serbia, in beautiful art festival context, and a big macho guy came and poked me in the middle, threw me over his shoulder and took me away. The lovely joy of live performance. I think that context is everything. I have some great colleagues from Belfast. I've just studied up there, and I'm in great awe of what they do. An amazing man called Alistair McLennan, and the group is called Be Beyond, and they perform on the street all the time. And that's, there you have no control.
Because you don't have an audience.
Well, people are going about their shopping, and then, you know, someone has a target on their head, or they're eating plastic bags. Really interesting actions to make. So they're constantly, but Alistair's work is all about challenging the context, the social context of Belfast and the trouble, post-troubles.
Question there, Luke.
Amanda, just a kind of a general question, looking at the video.
Yeah.
Or video, as it's called.
Whatever it is.
It reminds me a bit of action painting.
Yeah, yeah.
And the idea, I'm thinking about the speed of it.
I will totally.
Is there a sense in which, and I was just looking at the staircase, is there a sense in which the body is the material, the canvas, the garments, textiles, clothes are the pigment, and that what you're actually doing is reenacting. If paint could pink, and if a canvas had a life of its own.
Yeah.
What should be like to be painted?
Yeah.
And what's like for a painting? Like?
What a beautiful analogy. Mm.
And this in particular, especially the use of colour.
Yeah.
Is there a sense of which? And I know Alice Mahler uses hair as if it's a medium,
mm-hmm.
as if it's a kind of medium.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, canvas. Well, how very interesting. I'd never thought of it in those ways, but certainly when I was in a painting department, highly influenced by abstract expressionism and Pollock, particularly, and the action painters, that was my into performance art. That lots of people have different ways of getting into performance art, but certainly I came from that action painters, the action, the event, being the thing that attracted me more than the end product. That's really very, thank you for that. That's really interesting.
I've got two more questions, and we're going to have to wrap, otherwise we're going to get in trouble with the unions. I've got a question out of the back.
You were talking earlier about expanding your energy.
Yeah. I have worked with some male performers. No, only recently. It's terrible. I don't really know. I do. I suppose the fundamentality of the material that I use is the female body. Be very formal about that. And recently, men that I've invited in, actually, I was in Waterford there before Christmas. They had to have long hair and wear lipstick and be topless as well for some reason. So I really wanted, I'm really interested at the moment in the performance of gender and how that is and how we choose. And very much the work is about the performance of gender with the female, but with the female physicality attributes. What was the other part of your question, Harry? Sorry. Oh, yeah. Well, certainly, especially with 13 women, there was such a troop of us. There was an extension of that energy. And years ago, I had 100 people headbang to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, about 10 years ago now. And that was like a wall of energy, but very short, and it was only a 7-minute performance. So certainly multiplicity, it's like anything, sometimes it can fall off the radar and sometimes not, but it's really important to me for me to workshop with performers and to describe this notion of presence, the way to hold your body, the way I want them to hold their body in performance, that is not naturalistic. There's a very particular stand that makes it sculptural, makes it more communicated in a different way. Yeah.
Good. So I have to wrap it up. I'll take one more question. Sorry, because I got to go to that woman at the back there, in the middle. Yeah.
It strikes me that when you talk about the energy in the audience, that there's something primal about it in the relationship, and that you're moving from the unknown, exploring the unknown in that way, and moving maybe to the known, something about the human condition.
I think that it very much, the medium, for want of a better term, of performance art absolutely speaks to the human condition. And I think that each work is read in a very different way by everybody who comes and sees them. And which is part of the reason why I'm always a little reticent to talk about the whys of making things, because everyone who comes, we all come to works of art with our own personal history, our personal baggage, or nuances, or tastes, or likes. And what happens magically for me is when I make a work, mostly in live performance, I get these feedback from people that with things that I've never considered, that are wonderful, gorgeous insights or stories that are so rich that they have read into the work something that hits the or speaks to them about the human condition. Yeah, absolutely. And I might necessarily have been going there rationally in my layers of why I'd make something. Oh, I want to buy Penny's coats. I want to spit all over them. I want to paint them as I'm walking around for 8 hours with spit in my mouth. Not, you know, I'm also thinking about labor, cheap labor. I'm thinking about all of these different layers. And then somebody is coming to me afterwards talking about carrying people on your back, this whole notion. You know, really wonderful readings. And for me, it's really important, critically important, that everybody's reading of the work is right. That I'm not the font of knowledge. I offer these works for people to interpret them or read them whatever way they want. I'm not the genius artist with everything dotted and prossed and all the rest. So yeah, but in it talks about the human condition, but in everybody's nuanced way.
I think we want to thank you for your generosity this evening.
Well, thank you very much. What a lovely audience.
Yeah, thanks so much, Amanda.